Good evening and welcome to tonight's show. I am your host, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. If you have any comments or questions during the program, please feel free to call in at 610-378-0426. In a little over a week, we're going to be in the year 2016. And my guest, retired Senator Roy Afflerbach, made this comment in an article he had written. He said, and I quote, "There is no better time than now to make friends with our public officials in preparation for their support of humane legislation." I want to introduce Senator Roy Afflerbach. Thank you for being here. So explain why we should do this, become friends with our public officials.
Absolutely. I'll be happy to do that, Tina. But first, let me say that I know that you and your viewers of this program are all individuals who are very, very interested in public affairs and in helping to direct the direction that public affairs take. So it's always a pleasure for me to come here and join with you and be able to offer some, perhaps, advice, if you will, or at least some thoughts about how people can most effectively do that. And right now clearly is a very good time for individuals to call upon their public officials, to call upon them in the sense of sending them a holiday card, perhaps, sending them an email, making a telephone call, stopping by their offices to visit them. And when I say public officials, I mean at both the local level and at the state level, the congressional level. Because we're going into 2016, as you indicated, which is an election year. It's an election year for state officials, it's an election year for congressional officials, but there are many local officials that have just been elected in 2015. And some of them are brand new, and they need to be educated upon the issues that they'll be facing and how they're going to try to deal with them. We're in a perfect position to help educate them with respect to humane treatment of animals.
So we'll be reaching 2016 next Friday. So on the 4th, do you suggest we start contacting them then?
Oh, for the officials who were just elected this past November, I would begin contacting them immediately into the new year because they'll all be taking their oath of office. Those who were re-elected will also be taking their oath of office. And that's a good time to get off to a fresh start with them for their term of office, which is, and for most cases, for local officials, it's a four-year term of office. So it's a good way to get started with them. It's also a good way to begin watching the newspapers, the news media, the TVs, the radio stations for those candidates who are going to be running for the state legislature. Remember that every seat in the state house is up for election in 2016, and half of the state senate seats are up for election. So there will be candidates coming out declaring their candidacy early in the year because it's a presidential year, so the Pennsylvania primary election will take place in April, which is a month earlier than usual. Therefore, the time for candidates to come out, declare their candidacy, begin to circulate petitions for nomination and so on, is going to begin in late January. Perfect time to get to meet these individuals who are running for re-election, if you haven't already met them, and to meet the new individuals who may want to go and serve in the legislature or the Congress.
Let's talk about the local public officials who were just voted in.
Yes.
Okay, someone comes up to you and says, how do I approach a public official? I mean, it's very easy, I guess, to send an email. Do you suggest that we call and meet them? And if so, how do we go about doing that?
Well, calling to meet someone face-to-face is always best, because an email is a quick way of getting in touch with someone, but it's also not a very personal way. Actually meeting the individual face-to-face, being able to shake hands with them, being able to look them directly in the face and in the eye, being able to hear their voice and have them hear your voice, is every time that we can involve our five senses in a conversation with someone, we have a much better opportunity of having a successful meeting with that person. And that's the purpose of local officials as well. They should be close enough that you can actually call their office, set up an appointment to meet them, tell them what you'd like to talk to them about, and just basically say, this is a meet and greet. We'd like to be able to, you know, come in, talk to you for a little while, find out what your issues may be. Do you need information that we might be able to provide to you? And we'd like to tell you what our concerns may be here at the local level.
Are they always receptive to meeting their constituents in person?
Elected officials are almost always receptive to meeting their constituents in person. In fact, they try very diligently to meet as many of their constituents in person as they can, because they too understand that it is that personal touch that oftentimes leads to support in the future. And very few public officials go into office to say, okay, I'm going in one term and out. Basically, they go into office to make a difference. And they know that to be able to make that difference and do so in a positive fashion requires them to meet people, talk with people, find out what people think about things, and then be able to make the decision that way. There's a woman named Penny Ellison who wrote an excellent article, and I can see you're familiar with it by nodding. Penny's title of that article, if I recall correctly, was Think Globally and Act Locally.
Right.
And the whole purpose of the article was to tell people that on a day-to-day basis, they can have a greater impact in public policy at the local level than they can anywhere else.
Do you think people, animal advocates, realize that? Because I think we sometimes have grandiose ideas that we want to save the world.
Absolutely.
Save, you know, make changes in this state, nationwide, globally.
Correct.
But we can have a great impact locally that can impact globally, as Penny said in her article.
Right, that is correct, because every community, one at a time, affects what's going to happen in the county, affects what's going to happen in the state, and affects what's going to happen in the country, and so on out the door into the world. So, can they have an impact? Absolutely. And many more people are beginning to understand that. For years, Pennsylvania has been asked to pass a law that would prevent tethering animals 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, in all kinds of weather. The state government, the legislature, has been unable to pass that. So, individuals began to petition their local councils. And lo and behold, the city of Pittsburgh now has a tethering bill in place, a tethering act that they passed by council. Harrisburg has a tethering act. More and more municipalities and more people in those municipalities are coming to understand that they can have that impact locally. They don't have to wait for the state legislature to do something over a period of 5, 6, 10, 20 years, however long it takes. There's also an oblique way about going to your local officials to be able to accomplish a task that perhaps we haven't been able to do in the state legislature. I know that many people in Berks County, certainly, and in the surrounding areas of your viewers tonight, know about the mass pigeon shoots that took place in Higgins some years ago, and they ended there, but there are still some mass pigeon shoots taking place, one at Wing Point in Berks County, and then, of course, at the Bucks County Sportsman's Group. That's about it in Pennsylvania. However, we haven't been able to get the state legislature to act along with most other states and just completely forbid that kind of mass live animal target practice.
Right.
But in Pittsburgh, they found a way to help, and that is to prohibit the trapping of pigeons in the city of Pittsburgh. Because these pigeons are not just simply taken out of people's barns somewhere.
Right.
The people who have supplied these pigeons to these chutes go into the cities where they're likely to find more pigeons, and they bait them with grain or corn or what have you, and when the pigeons come out around the train station or the bus station or some such place, they throw nets over them, roll them up in the nets, throw them in the back of a van and take off with them and then sell them for these chutes. So Pittsburgh has moved ahead and has now forbidden the trapping of pigeons within the city. New York has done that for years. The trapping of pigeons in the city of New York has been forbidden for years. More and more municipalities are finding that the individuals in more and more municipalities are finding that their local governments can take action that the state has just been unable to take for years.
Right. There are quite a few bills that are sitting there.
Yes.
I mean, look at our dog law that sat there for decades.
The puppy mill bill.
What's that?
The puppy mill bill, that dog law?
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I sit there for decades, and other bills sit there for years, and now we have a chance on a local level to change that. I think it's great with Pittsburgh, you know, with the pigeons and the anti-tethering.
Mm-hmm. And Pittsburgh did the same thing on puppy mills. They also now have two ordinances in place. One of those would forbid the sale of puppies and kittens in the city of Pittsburgh that have come from a mill source. And that could be outside of Pennsylvania. Doesn't have to be a Pennsylvania puppy mill. It could be a Missouri puppy mill. The second ordinance also prohibits the advertising for sale of a small animal of that nature without having a paper trail verifying that this animal did not come from a puppy mill. So Pittsburgh really is leading the way in Pennsylvania in terms of a progressive municipality that is dealing with animal issues because the state has refused to.
So why do you think this is happening in Pittsburgh?
Because we have a number of individuals out there. Many of the people are very much like the people watching your program tonight. They are invested in trying to move forward with the compassionate treatment of animals, and they have found a way to do it because they have been able to help elect local council people to the City Council of Pittsburgh and a mayor who also want to move forward with the compassionate treatment of animals and end some of these horrendous things that have been happening. And every municipality in this Commonwealth, whether it's a city, a borough, a township, has the same capability. All that is required is for the individuals, the local people living in those municipalities, to come together as they did in Pittsburgh, help to elect local officials who will then take that path of action.
So that can be done here in this area?
Oh, absolutely it can. It can be done in Reading, it can be done in the townships.
Anywhere, I mean, throughout Pennsylvania, we could turn this whole thing around with puppy mills or with any animal issue. Do you feel that it's going to start more on a local level now to change what's happening in Pennsylvania?
No question about it. In fact, one of the things I do for the Humane Society of the United States is travel throughout the state and coach individuals on how they can be the most effective animal advocates within their municipalities as well as within the state. To lobby at the local level?
To one
That's
of
right, you have.
Years ago. Yes.
That's correct, yes. And that was focused, of course, on the state legislature. But now we're moving in the direction of local municipalities because we have found that it's twofold. First of all, as we've discussed, you can sometimes make progress much faster where you're dealing with your neighbors on a daily basis. And secondly, it's easier for the people who are the advocates to be able to talk to their neighbors on a daily basis. They don't generally have to travel as far. There's a closer relationship right from the beginning. It's their municipality. It's their community. It's where they live, as opposed to sending someone down to Harrisburg who might be anywhere from 10 miles to 500 miles away from their home. And that 500 is not an exaggeration. If you go all the way up the tip of Erie and come all the way down to Harrisburg.
I've known people who have traveled a distance to go to Harrisburg.
Yes, yes.
I have a couple of questions that people have written to me. BG, I don't know if this is a man or woman, wants to know about the intimidation factor about meeting public officials. I said, what do they do about that? They feel intimidated.
Well, yeah, the thing is that people, and I understand that, because I, you know, I came out of a farm community as a young man. I had never actually met public officials beyond the township supervisors. And the first time I went to Harrisburg to begin to meet anybody in the state legislature, I too felt intimidated about it. I shouldn't have, but I did. And the reason we should not is because these people work for us. We hire them at the polling booth.
Do you think that's a mindset that we don't have, that
that's
they're working for us?
That's correct. It's a mindset we don't have. Most people believe that they just can't approach this powerful person who has this title. But that powerful person only has that title because people such as you and I and everybody else who's watching the program go out and participate in elections and elect them to that title and to that position. And so the first thing I think we have to understand is that we should never feel intimidated about approaching an elected official. That person has that job because we have given them that job. We are their employers as citizens in the municipality or in the state. The second purpose that we should keep in mind is that for an elected official, knowledge is power, and we can give them knowledge that they may not have. We can help them understand issues in ways that they may not otherwise get the information they need to understand that issue. And so we have a valuable resource for them. And a good elected official, in fact, nearly all elected officials, good or not, but the best ones understand that they need the information that we can provide to them. And they are therefore happy to meet with us or to have their key staff people meet with us if it's something where urgency is required. I have never found in the years, and I've been there now for a long time, since December of 1970.
Let's see. You served as senior staff of the Pennsylvania Senate. You were a two-term member of the State House of Representatives, three-term state senator, and the mayor of Allentown.
Yes.
And so you have all this vast experience. How did you want people to approach you?
Basically, I just wanted them to, now of course today you can send an email to do it, but either make a telephone call or send an email asking for an appointment and saying, you know, here's what I'd like to talk to you about. And if that person was residing in the district which I represented, I felt compelled as an elected official from that district to meet with that person and hear what they had to say, what their story was, what information they could bring to us. And I always encourage people to do that. And if it was of some urgency and I couldn't meet with them directly because I was in Harrisburg and they were in Allentown or Lehigh County, then I would have one of my senior staff people meet with them. To be able to get the information, that person would then brief me at an appropriate time, and sooner or later we'd get to face-to-face with the individual who wanted to meet me. So most elected officials have that policy. At the local level, they certainly have that policy. because they know if they don't take time to meet with you now when you call to ask to meet with them, you may stop them in the grocery store or the gas station or some other place around town where you're likely to see them. They would much rather have a structured meeting than have a quick catch-as-catch-can along the sidewalk meeting somewhere. But there are also many local officials who find it very valuable to go out and walk through their municipalities and chat with people as they go through the municipality. So that's another opportunity to start the conversation. There really are all types of opportunities. One should never feel intimidated about talking with an elected official. The critical element is just always be polite. And if you're always polite, they have no reason to not want to talk with you.
What about when, if we receive emails from an organization and they say they already have the form letter, all you have to do is type in your name, your address, and everything?
Mm-hmm.
Is that effective?
No, that's not effective. It's only effective to this extent. If there are a sizable number, and that sizable number varies based upon whether you're talking about a municipality or a state legislative seat or whatever it may be, if there's a sizable number of those types of letters coming in, it simply alerts the elected official to the fact that there's some interest group out there circulating these letters. And whatever that interest group may be, it's not too hard to find out usually. That's their opinion. People are signing these letters, but are they really committed to it? So it's much better to take that form letter, use it as a template, if you will, and then write your own letter based upon the information that has been given to you. When your letter comes through and it's worded in the way that you would word it, that carries much more weight with the elected official. The same thing is true with petitions. People circulate petitions. Well, I can assure you, I could take a petition out for almost anything and get signatures on it. Some people would sign it just to get me off their porch. So we don't pay a lot of attention to the petitions either. Again, it will raise the fact that there's somebody out there who's very, very committed to bringing an issue to us. To that extent, it's valuable, but not in terms of how that issue will be decided.
So the petitions are, I see them circulating all the time.
Yes.
To sign this and that for animals. And
yes.
You're saying that I personally don't sign them, but you're saying they're really not truly effective.
They're really not truly effective. Because, again, elected officials come to know fairly quickly that there is a small number of people who are totally dedicated to putting forth their viewpoint. And they often try to do so by petition to make it appear as though there's 150 or 350 or 3,000 people who feel exactly the same way they do. Mm-hmm. And that's why I go back to say, to the extent of raising an issue so that it's in front of the legislature or in front of the public official, to that extent a petition is perhaps some value, but it's not going to help decide the issue.
Okay.
What helps to decide the issue is the one-on-one discourse between the constituent and the elected official or a group of constituents. You know, if you and I just went in on our own to talk to an elected official, unless they had a particular interest in our issue, we probably wouldn't get too far. But if we have a group of friends who go in with us, or we have a group of friends who personally make those contacts rather than just signing a petition, that then begins to move the issue. And that's really the most effective way of moving it.
I have a question from Linda. She said, and I think we may have covered this, Linda, but she wants to know, why don't more bills get passed in the state of Pennsylvania for animals?
Well, there's actually, for these past two sessions, we've had more bills introduced to show compassionate treatment of animals, and more passed in any one session than we had for probably 40 years before that.
Why is that?
Well, part of the reason is, believe it or not, the internet and social networking. Things like Facebook and Twitter and these types of methods of communication with individuals. I also happen to work with a group called Humane PA, a political action committee. When we began Humane PA about 8 years ago...
Which you are the founder, former president, and now you're the treasurer.
That's correct, okay. Yes. I've moved from one step to another. When we began it, we didn't quite know how well we could succeed or what we could do. Today we have 37,000 people in Pennsylvania that have signed on as members of Humane PA PAC. We don't have a lot of money. We don't focus on giving money to candidates in order to try to win votes. What we focus upon is having people in the local districts contact their elected officials, their officials in Harrisburg, to let them know how they feel on a given issue. And through this 37,000 people and through this one organization, we've been able to bring the attention of the plight of animals in many instances, to legislators in a way that we just couldn't do before. It wasn't cost-effective to be able to do it before. Now it is. So that's one of the big reasons. But it still comes down to the same bottom line. People must step forth and be active themselves and make those contacts directly themselves to their legislator.
So when did Humane PA start?
Just about 8 years ago.
8 years ago.
Yes.
Did you envision this with 37,000 people?
Absolutely not. There was no way in the world I could envision that. We were actually hoping we might get as many as 5,000 across the state. Because understand that 5,000 people across the state, even a state the size of Pennsylvania, can be a significant lobbying force if they're contacting their local officials and their local state representatives and senators. Most legislators don't receive more than a dozen or two dozen letters or telephone calls on any given issue. So if they're suddenly now receiving 40, 50, 60 on a given issue, believe me, that catches their attention.
So you're saying lobby, and the first thing that pops in my mind, the lobby group, the NRA. Okay, all right.
Well, see, this is an interesting point, and I will make this point, and that is this, that when it comes to animal issues, by and large, they're a bipartisan issue until the NRA steps in, and then the Republicans run for cover, because that is one of their core constituencies. So if the NRA steps in and says, oppose this, you can bet that the bill is not going to see the light of day in a Republican-controlled legislature. It's as simple as that. As long as the NRA stays out of it, we have many good Republicans who will support us on animal issues.
So why is the NRA, they don't want pigeon shoots to be illegal. They don't want
Correct.
That on the books because they fear that this will interfere with hunters, and hunting. And that is not what a bill to end pigeon shoots is all about.
No, that's correct. That's correct. The NRA fails to make the distinction between what is a legitimate hunting issue and what is not, and what is a legitimate gun issue and what is not. And so when they come out on their basis, which for many, many years was simply the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms, that's one set of issues. That has nothing to do with what type of a weapon is used in pigeon shoots, whether it's a firearm or whether it's a bow and arrow. Furthermore, when the NRA gets involved on issues that are not directly related to Second Amendment rights, one has to question, why are they doing this? Is it because they are well-funded by the firearms manufacturers and they, of course, want to sell weapons? And is it because on the pigeon issue that Pennsylvania is the only state where they can openly, legally practice these mass live pigeon shoots? And they don't want to shut that down. But if one goes to any of these pigeon shoots that take place, you can't get on the property because it's restricted property, it's private property, but you can watch the automobiles going in, you can watch the make of the automobile, and you can watch the license plate on the automobile, and it will soon occur to even the dimmest person that these are not everyday folks going into these shoots. These
Right.
are wealthy individuals coming in from other states where they cannot legally do this.
I mean, I find it absurd, as all animal advocates do, that we cannot and the
yes.
pigeon shoots. Even hunters themselves are against
yes.
these pigeon shoots.
Yes,
like you said. I mean, this is on a different scale. I mean, it's for prizes, it's for money.
Yes.
And but do you think we'll ever get this passed?
Yes, I do. We came very close in the last session, as close as we have ever been. People thought that the Senate would never pass the bill. Well, the Senate not only passed the bill, they passed the bill with a veto-proof majority. The House Majority Leader, now the Speaker of the House, Mike Turzai, had given us a commitment that if the Senate passed the bill, he would bring it to a vote. He flat out broke his commitment. So it should be no surprise to anybody why the state budget is having problems that it's having right now, because you have the same gentleman leading the House Republican caucus that broke his commitment to us, breaking his commitment to the governor and the Senate Republicans and all the Democrats as well. It's a situation that we have in Pennsylvania, which unfortunately, until some personalities change, and until some leadership posts change, we're going to have a very difficult time. But we are getting there, step by step.
Okay.
The key is don't give up.
We have about a minute left. Do you want to give the Humane PA's information now if people want to contact it?
Oh, yes. If people would like to contact Humane PA, or if you're interested in just simply getting a list of all of the bills affecting animals which are currently in the state legislature, simply go to the website HumanePAPAC. That's HumanePAPAC. And I think it might be a .org, but doesn't matter. If you Google it,
it's .org.
HumanePAPAC.org,
yeah,
you'll find
it. Yeah, but like you said, you can Google it.
Sure.
Any phone numbers that anyone should know about?
No.
Okay.
Just all the information they will need is on that website.
And you have a Facebook page, too, at the Humane
we
PA.
Do.
All the information goes
Correct.
Through there, and I think
Correct.
They can give their emails, and they can be updated
Absolutely.
All the time. And we still have a little bit of time. What bit of advice would you give to everyone? For the New Year's coming in 30 seconds or less?
Well, in 30 seconds or less, I would say this. New Year's resolutions are coming. So make a New Year resolution that if you have not yet registered to vote, do so if you're of age to do so. If you have not yet met your local officials, make a resolution to do so. If you have not yet met your state officials, make a resolution to do so. And if you set off in that start, you'll have a great beginning to the year.
Well, I want to thank you, Roy, for being here. Always a pleasure.
Thank you, Tina, and always a pleasure with you as well.
Thank you. And that's it for 2015. We will see you next year. Happy holidays.